two things are needed. For a proper performance of the act of conquest of nature, investigation in the field of physical sciences is essential. But this investigation in the field of physical sciences alone is not what will make a person Khalifatullah. He may subjugate the forces of nature, but remember this point here, he has got to subjugate the forces of nature in the name of God. Yani, subjugating the forces of nature can be possible for a person who is an atheist, because as a human being he is also with all those capacities which have been given to man as Khalifatullah. But the duty of a Muslim is to conquer nature in the name of Allah. This is the difference. I mean, say this conquest of the moon, this was entrusted to the Muslims. And because they slept all these centuries and they forgot everything which they were told, and they were just contented with their prayer mat and their tasbih if they wanted to become pious, they had no idea absolutely, and even today they have no idea that they are Khalifatullah and this is their function. So, they stand nowhere. Now this, in order to conquer nature in the name of Allah, it is necessary to conquer one's own lower self. In order to make one's personality disciplined. The conquest of the lower self, about which the Quran says, "Inna an-nafsa la'ammaratun bis-su illa ma rahima rabbi." And about which the Quran says that this nafsul ammara has got to be transformed into an-nafsul mutmainna, or the ego at peace with God and peace with this world. Ya ayyatuha an-nafsul mutmainna irji'i ila rabbika radiyatan mardiyah. So this entire activity has got to be taken in such a fashion that the lower self has got to be conquered, that is the conquest of the self. The world has got to be conquered, that is the conquest of nature. For that, a Muslim Sufi or the Muslim community as a whole will have to undertake the study of all physical sciences, of all normative sciences, of all the different branches of knowledge. Knowledge and Iman should proceed here together. And the clue to it is found in the Quran. It is not I who am saying it. Of course, nowadays Iman is considered to be divorced from knowledge. But in the Quran we have been told clearly, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ درجات. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exalts those who cultivate Iman and exalts those who are endowed with knowledge to high ranks. Here Iman and Ilm have been talked together. Here Zikrullah and Fikr fi khalqis samawati wal ard has been brought together. This is the goal, this is the way, this is the methodology for the Muslim community as it was given. And in this methodology, the tasawwuf plays the most important role. This is what it teaches. While the general type of man among Muslims says, Sharia is enough for me, the tasawwuf says, what are you saying? Sharia enough for what? Ghalib says, Jama'e ihrame zahid par naja. Jama'e ihrame zahid par naja. Tha haram mein ek na mahram raha. Don't go on the ihram of the haji. He was ignorant of God even while he was in the haram. Don't go after the ihram of the haji. This ihram is of no importance, because when this haji was in the haram, he was ignorant of God completely. It is not the ihram. It is not my turban which is speaking before you. It is not this jubbah which is speaking before you. It is I who am speaking. And this I is there within and not outside. Understand what I am saying. I think I have said enough about the at-tariqah. I should now come to the next stage, the fourth stage, that of al-ma'rifah. When this methodology is undertaken for internalizing the sharia, and a person starts his travel on the road of abdiyat or being slave of God, when his will and the will of God become harmonized, then the doors of true knowledge are open to him according to the Quran. Then he understands what he is. Then he understands what the world is. Then he understands according to his capacity what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. He travels inside himself. He travels outside of himself. He tries to understand what he is inside. He tries to understand what the world is there of which he is a member. And this entire creation of God, as Shaykh Sadi says, har gaya hai ke az-zameer yad wahdahu la shareek mein guyad. Every blade of grass which sprouts from the earth, every blade of grass which sprouts from the earth bear witness and proclaims that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one without a partner. This is to proceed to the realization of God through his creation. And of course, only through his creation you can realize. God you cannot see. The voice of God you cannot hear. God cannot become an object of your knowledge as these material things are. So, the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has taught, concentrate your pursuit of knowledge on creation of God and not on God himself, because he is beyond your pursuit of knowledge. He is beyond your pursuit of knowledge. He cannot be an object of your knowledge. Your reason and your powers of perception and observation are so limited that you cannot make God as the object of your knowledge. But you can know him through his ayat, through his signs which are spread all over. And this understanding of the signs of God, which are spread in everything and which the scientist undertakes, the Holy Quran says that those who love God, those who really believe in God, they are after these signs that they want to comprehend them. And about the kuffar, it says, وَكَأَيِّمْ مِنْ آيَةٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ يَمُرُّونَ عَلَيْهَا وَهُمْ عَنْهَا مُعْرِضُونَ. Or how many people are there who just see the signs of God in front of them, but they pass by these signs of God, turning their face and not trying to comprehend them. This realization of God through his creation, the realization of his majesty, the realization of his wisdom, the realization of his beauty, the realization of all the various aspects of his personality, comes to the spiritual pilgrim, to the Sufi, through his contemplation of God's creation together with this zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when he arrives at that stage, then it is said, then the fifth stage comes, and that is the stage of al-haqiqah. Now he arrives at the last point beyond which he cannot go. He arrives at the point where he realizes the ultimate reality, that is God. And therefore he cries out. First he cries out in that verse where this methodology has been given. I will read the verse again. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ لِّأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا. That is the first realization. When this methodology is adopted, then the first realization is that, O my Lord, Thou hast not created anything in vain. This is a very unhappy translation of the word batil. Batil means baseless, batil means something which is out of proportion, batil means something which is inconsequential, batil means something which is unreal, batil means something which is useless. Batil has numerous shades of meaning. Of course, the English language is too poor to translate the word batil. But this is the realization that comes, رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا. And then comes the next realization, سُبْحَانَكْ Thou art in Thy majesty and wisdom and greatness, super and super and super and super. وَرَاءُ الْوَرَى ثُمَّ وَرَاءُ الْوَرَى ثُمَّ وَرَاءُ الْوَرَى. So blessed art thou, so perfect art thou, that not the slightest imperfection can even be imagined about the Subhanak. These are the two realizations mentioned in this verse. And these realizations are called in the thought of the Sufis, Al-Haqiqah. And here it ends. Al-Hikmah, Al-Shari'ah, Al-Tariqah, Al-Ma'rifah. These five levels, this is tasawwuf. And then it can be understood even by a child. It can be understood even by a child that a Muslim who undergoes these enormous labors and tortures in his journey towards God, God is infinitely generous. What rewards are there conceivable that he will not be given? Because he says for the life hereafter, لَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَدْعُونَ. The Jannat will not be just a casual thing like the good house here, with some sofa sets and this and that, you see. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you will get there whatever you want. He has not set any limit. He has not set any limit to His blessings in the Jannah. How can there be limit to His blessings in this life for a Sufi? How can there be limits in this life for His abd? He who has become abd, he who says, O God, I don't know anyone but Thee, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'een. I don't worship anyone except Thee and I seek all the help from Thee. Will Allah give him just one piece of biscuit and a cup of tea? How frivolous is the thinking of it. How degenerated is the thinking of the people. It is a blasphemy against God to say that after all these tortures, after all these hardships, as they say in Urdu, wohi dhaak ke teen paath, chale ja rahe hain Sufi sahab apni daadhi latkaye huye, bas, aur koi cheez nahi mili. What is? This is not understandable, my dear friends. And if God is like that, we have no need to believe in Him. Let Him be where He is. Why should we? If we are going to get the same suki roti by believing in God and by not believing in God, what is the need of believing in Him? Why? I believe in a God, my God, who is taught to me by no less than the holy, no less a person than the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, the God which he has told me, this is your God, he introduces himself as Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. He introduces himself as Rabbul Alameen. He introduces himself as Zul Fadl al-Azim. He introduces himself as bestower of rewards for virtue at least 10 times of that, and of course to the maximum, Allah knows best, it may be 1,000,000 times. About this God to say that this two-legged creature will just creep like that, and as he had been creeping, oh, he will fly. He can't creep. He cannot creep. He will fly and he will be the master of this universe, remember this. And the Awliya Allah had been that. Ask Shah Waliullah, who was the Imam of the 19th century. Greater than whom has not yet been born up to this year. This great man, Shah Waliullah, ask him. Not ask the pygmy Maulvis, you see, who talk nonsense. Ask him. And he says about Sayyidina Ghausul Azam Muhyiddin Sayyid Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, and compare with that fellow who came here and when we talked about Ghausul Azam, that Ghausul Azam had a wrestling combat with God. And you heard it, and many people recommended his case and said he is a saint. Ask Shah Waliullah. He says about Ghausul Azam, يَتَصَرَّفُ فِي قَبْرِهِ كَمَا كَانَ يَتَصَرَّفُ فِي حَيَاتِهِ. Ask Shah Waliullah. He says about Ghausul Azam, يَتَصَرَّفُ فِي قَبْرِهِ كَمَا كَانَ يَتَصَرَّفُ فِي حَيَاتِهِ. He says that Ghausul Azam interferes in the order of this world up to this day from his qabr, as he used to do it when he was alive in his physical body. This is Shah Waliullah speaking. This is the mujaddid of this age speaking, not an ordinary Modi. And why should he not? What do you mean by this Khalifatullah? Any person who undergoes all this hardship and torture in the way of God and for the love of God, what should he become? I was speaking one day about the concept of Khalifatullah. Let me take it up where I left. The word Khalifa in Arabic can mean one who comes after. فَخَلَفَ مِن بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ. Then after them came those who had to come after them. There cannot be before and after for God. There cannot be before and after for God, because He is infinite, and the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has taught this clearly, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no before and no after. He is eternal and He is infinite. Then Khalifatullah is not Khalifatullah in the sense that He is after God. Not at all. The word Khalifa can mean deputy. The Queen of England can send a viceroy to Australia, because the Queen of England cannot administer Australia due to her limitations as a human being. So she appoints another person with her prerogatives given to him, and he is called the viceroy, deputy of the king. Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala need a viceroy? If he needs, then he is not God. Clear? He says about himself in the Holy Quran, Wallahu bikulli shay'in muhit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comprehends everything. Wallahu ala kulli shayin qadir. He is almighty. What for does he need a deputy or a viceroy? Then what is the meaning of this Khalifatullah? The meaning of this Khalifatullah, ask from the Arifin. Ask from those great men whose mind alone was not illumined, but also their heart was illumined. And here I may tell you one very important point. Remember it. Nobody can be the representative of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Nobody can be waris of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam whose mind and heart both are not illumined. And consequently, it was only the Sufis and nobody else. Read the life of Ghausul Azam. He acquired knowledge to the highest, book knowledge. And he acquired this spiritual illumination also to the highest of his capacity. He was the waris of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and not we who can just talk glibly with our tongue, nothing beyond that. It is said, Al-ulama'u warasatul anbiya. The ulama are the inheritors of the mission of the Prophet, certainly. But which ulama? Do kitab wale ulama. Those who go to this institution and that institution, you see, these madrasas, small madrasas of theology, and read their 5 books and come back, are the ulama. Imam Abu Hanifa was alim. And Imam Shafi'i was alim. And Imam Fakhruddin Razi was alim. And I am not capable even to be their student. What these people are going about? I am alim, and this is Jam'iyatul Ulama, and this is this and that. I cannot understand at all. We should not be so self-conceited. We are not ulama. I have spent 50 years in the pursuit of knowledge. I have studied 27 branches of knowledge. And I have gone to the highest degree of PhD. But ask me, I'll say, swear by God, that I even now know only the ABC of Islam. Islam is an ocean. It is an unfathomable ocean of wisdom. And when I see people who are ignorant and who have no knowledge, not to speak even of spiritual illumination, coming forward and creating mischief in the Muslim community, I feel ashamed of myself and of the word alim and of the word muballigh. What do you mean by that? Who is muballigh? Who is muballigh? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the anbiya alone muballigh. That is their function. The Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is messenger of God. Remember this point. And anybody who wants to preach Islam will be only his messenger. I ask those who do tabligh, have you got message from the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? Have you got any authority from him? It is said that Khwaja Muhyiddin Chishti of Ajmer was given farman by the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that he should go to Ajmer. And look at his wonderful work. That work is not like my work, who is also called a missionary. The Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam gave the farman and the order and the authority to Ghausul Azam to go and sit in Baghdad. And he changed the whole course of history. He was a muballigh. Not every Tom, Dick, Harry is a muballigh. What do you mean by that? How far into the gutter are you going to take Islam and to take the name of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? Why don't you wish to rise high to those great heights to which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls you? Anybody who is less educated is a very pious Muslim and a Maulvi Sahib. Wonderful. Then the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam must have been a small man whose emissaries are like that, then he must also have been a small man. And the God who sent him must also be a very small deity. People, things cannot stay in this world out of proportion. If I am the greatest, then the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam definitely must be very small. Because I am small. And if I am the greatest, then he also must be small. And this, that he was so great and he is Ashraful Anbiya and Sayyidul Mursaleen and Sayyidul Bashar. What do you mean? Only words? May I tell you who is the Khalifa? Ask the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam who is the Khalifa. Why should I say? The hadith is in the Siha. And there we are told by the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, who is the only authority on Islam. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when my servant performs all the obligations that I have placed on him in the code of law that I have given, in the code of life that I have given, and then on his own behalf, with his own enthusiasm, he goes on the path of righteousness and purity in things which I have not commanded him. لا يزال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه. When any servant of mine does like this, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I make him my beloved. فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ. And when I have made him my beloved, this is the talk, mind you, about the slaves of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, not about him, about his followers. فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ كُنْتُ سَمْعُهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ وَبَصَرُهُ الَّذِي يَبْصُرُ بِهِ. I become his ears with which he hears. I become his eyes with which he sees. I become his tongue with which he speaks. I become his mind with which he thinks. I become his hands with which he holds. And I become his feet with which he walks. This is the Khalifatullah. Tell me honestly, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about a person that he has become his eyes, then this person's eyes, will there be anything in this entire universe? Will there be anything which will be absent from the eyes of this person? Can you think? It is impossible. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he has become the ears of a person, then will there be any sound in this entire universe which will not be heard by those ears? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have become the tongue with which he speaks, then can it be possible that that tongue may speak, that it will be so and it will not be so? What? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have become the feet of that person with which he walks, then what is that place in this universe where this person cannot be? This is hadith. This is not hearsay. This is not the opinion of so-and-so Maulana Sahib and so-and-so Peer Sahib. No. Maulana Sahib may speak wrongly, Peer Sahib may speak wrongly, but the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam cannot speak. This is the Khalifatullah. And may I relate to you incidents which I have seen and of which, first of all, the incident not about Khwaja Muinuddin Chishti of Ajmer, who is Sultan al-Hind. Who performs wonders even today? I am not speaking about him. I am speaking about a man who was much lower than him. I am speaking about Maulana Abdul Alim Siddiqui who came here. I was with Maulana Abdul Alim Siddiqui in his world tour in 1949-1950. And there are thousands of witnesses. It can be verified any time by anyone. It is not a false story. We arrived in the Philippines. Hazrat Maulana Abdul Alim Siddiqui rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh wa qaddasallahu ta'ala sirrahu al-aziz. We arrived in the Philippines. We were touring the Philippines. When we arrived in the island of in the city of Cotabato. Cotabato is the name of a province as well as the name of its capital. Cotabato has a population of about 30% Muslims and about 60% Christians and about 10% pagans. Now, the day when we arrived, this country of the Philippines, I may tell you, is a country where we have the rainfall all through the year, heavy rainfall. So when we arrived at Cotabato in the morning, it was announced there that Maulana Abdul Alim Siddiqui rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh will deliver a public address at the savannah or the open park in the evening after Salatul Maghrib. All right. At about 2 o'clock, a very furious type of army of black clouds, thick black clouds, started together over Cotabato with rumbling and thundering and threatening. At the other time, I and Maulana Abdul Alim Siddiqui met at the tea table because it was his habit to take some rest between Zohar and us. I was seeing this, the announcement had been made, and I was wondering as to how Maulana would be able to deliver the speech and how the function would be held. So I spoke in my anxiety at the tea table to Maulana, and there were many other people sitting there. I said, "Sir, have you noticed these thick clouds, black clouds, and I think probably we are going to have a very heavy stormy rain." Maulana looked at me, he smiled. He said, "Why do you care, my son? We are not here on our mission. Our mission is that of God Almighty. He controls us and He controls this rain. Why are you anxious?" And he started sipping his tea. When we had prayed Maghrib in the hotel where we were staying, a huge number of human beings had already come in order to occupy seats. There was a huge crowd, almost probably more than 30,000 or even more, a vast crowd. When we had offered the Salatul Maghrib, that threat from the skies above increased. The governor of Cotabato was to take the chair, and the chief justice of Cotabato and other ministers of that province, they were also there, most of them Christians. Maulana Abdul Alim Siddiqui rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh stood up after the introduction. I was sitting by his side, he was standing at the mic, and there was another mic where the interpreter was standing, because in order to translate into the local Filipino dialect. Maulana read the Khutba Masnoona, which I read also in Arabic before delivering the lecture. And then he is just started, my dear brothers, or something, your ladies and gentlemen, or something. And he had spoken hardly two sentences when big drops of rain started coming. Tap, tap, tap. And there was that thundering and that rumbling overhead. The people of that place knew that it was going to be a big storm. They knew that, so they commenced getting up. Allahu Akbar. I was sitting by Maulana Sahib on a chair and he was standing. Do you know what he said? Brothers, don't leave this place. This rain is going to stop immediately. And it will not rain until I have finished my lecture. Then after I have finished my lecture, you will get 10 minutes in order to go back to your homes. So do not come to the dais to shake hands with me. Remember this. And the rain stopped. There are thousands of persons alive up to this day in Cotabato who were eyewitnesses to this. And my heart started trembling in a sort of anxiety. What has he said? I mean, it is a challenge. How can he say that the rain is going to stop immediately and it will not come until I have finished my lecture and you have 10 minutes at your disposal after that to go back to your home? So after he had said this, then he again started. I was by his side just trying to notice as to whether there was even the slightest touch of anxiety, because when there is anxiety within, then a person who is speaking, I would say, it's slight shade, just come. Allahu Akbar. That evening he delivered the longest speech of his life, which I have heard. The thunder was there above, all the time threatening that I am coming. And Maulana Abdul Aleem Siddiqui was speaking with absolute calmness and with absolutely no concern. And that was also one of the most beautiful speeches of his on Islam, which I have heard. When he spoke for 1.5 hours, his habit was in those countries not to speak for more than 1 hour. But that night he spoke 1.5 hours, and after he had finished the speech and the chairman got up for the vote of thanks, proposed the vote of thanks and said the meeting is now adjourned, the people had forgotten everything, that they were fleeing from there like that, you see. So they started crowding on the dais. Then Maulana Abdul Aleem Siddiqui rahmatullahi ta'ala went to the microphone. He said, my brothers, you have forgotten that the rain had come and I told you this. You don't remember now. I tell you that it is only 10 minutes. Would you please leave for your homes and I am leaving for my hotel. And exactly after 10 minutes the rain came in such a stormy manner that in the morning water was standing at the roads 7 feet. And canoes were plying on those roads. I have seen many things. Many things have been recorded. I mean, this one incident. And do you know how many Christians became Muslim next day? They did not need any arguments now for Islam. I have taken up this incident because you know him, he came here. And you know him only as an alim. You don't know about his spiritual worth. I and he were to travel from New York to Edmonton in West Canada. The seats were booked. Intimation had been sent to Edmonton that we are coming by such and such flight. We had to take the flight in the morning from New York. The flight went from there at 7 o'clock. In the night, when I and he in the hotel, we performed namaz in congregation, there were some other people also there. He led the prayers. After this Isha prayers, he, after his salam in Fard, when he had finished with the salams, he turned towards me. He said, Fazlur Rahman, would you telephone to the air company that we are not going by the morning flight tomorrow? I said, sir, why? All arrangements have been made there and you have got to give a speech there tomorrow evening. He said, don't ask me this. Say it to the air company. So I said, all right, sir, then for what other date should I fix it up? He said, I'll tell you about it tomorrow. All right, I had to do as I was ordered. In the morning, this flight, this aircraft went to the sky at the appointed time, proceeded about 8 miles from New York and crashed, every passenger dying. And then he called and he said, now you say to the air company that we are going by tomorrow's flight in the morning. I will say, if a person becomes the slave of some great man here, whether he is great in wealth or he is great in power or great in anything, then if he is a poor man and he becomes the slave or he becomes such an intimate friend all the time flattering this wealthy man, he will not, this wealthy man, if he has even an iota of sharafat in him, then this wealthy man would not like this man to remain a pauper. What do you think about God? This is the Khalifatullah. And this Khalifatullah, about him the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has said, he says, among my ummah, there will be persons with shabby clothes on their bodies, with dust on their faces. But he says that if they raise their hands, if they would raise their hands before God, wallahi, those hands will never come back empty. This is the Wali Allah. This is what Tasawwuf stands for. This name, Tasawwuf, is given to that which is called in the Hadith Al-Ihsan. And whose methodology has been named in the Quran as tazkiyah, purification. This is the beautification of one's Islam. This is tasawwuf, about which in the hadith we are told, when Jibreel alayhi salam asked the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, mal ihsan, he answered, فَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ فَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. Serve thy Lord with this state of consciousness. To be capable of serving the Lord with this state of consciousness, that thou art seeing Him. This is Allah. And the lower stage of this al-ihsan is فَإِن لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ. So long as it is not possible for thee to have the vision of God, then thou shouldst have at least this consciousness in a very positive manner, that thou art serving Him and He is seeing thee. This is the whole story of the tasawwuf. I have numerous other dimensions in this problem on which I should have spoken, but I have taken too much of your time, my dear friends, and I have spoken with all my heart and with all my sincerity and with all my responsibility. I hope I have made this concept of tasawwuf clear to you. But before I leave, I would again like to speak a few more words. Why in Islam it was not called Al-Ihsan and it came to be known by the word Tasawwuf? You see, when Muslims had conquered a huge empire, they became very prosperous. Every Muslim had a lot of money. There was no Muslim left in the empire who could be given zakat. Everyone was zakat payer. This prosperity brought the materialistic outlook to make more money, that which is called in Urdu Ninnanve ka phir, the vicious circle of 99, to count up to 99 and then to start from one again. That these 99 which I have earned, they are just nothing, let it be kept there in the safe, and now I should think myself as a pauper and start again with one and again earn 99, so that is the only way of becoming a millionaire. This lust for the world and lust for wealth entered into the Muslim society. And those who became rulers, they did not allow the ulama to say what it was their duty to say and to interfere in the work of administration. Those ulama who were themselves weak-minded and of weak character, they were purchased by these rulers. And consequently, those who were genuine and sincere ulama, they thought that this community is going to dogs. In order to distinguish, they were also ulama, in order to distinguish between themselves and the others, they started this movement and said that we are pursuers of tasawwuf. That is, our goal in life is the pursuit of safa, of purity. Not merely of the Islamic law, but of the very spirit of Islamic law for the attainment of purity in thought, word and deed. And thus, this category of ulama became separated from the other category. They were then called fuqaha, and this category was called sufia. I would like all of you to remember one thing. Read the history of Islam. Those people who propagated Islam in the world, you will find that it was only the Sufis and nobody else. Can you imagine what great role they have played? Only the Sufis and nothing and nobody else. And still people have the cheek to abuse these Sufis. Is it not a matter of disgrace? And also read Islamic history and try to find out as to who were those people who were the most successful among the reformers belonging to the Muslim community. None of the ulama. Only the Sufis, whether it was in India, Imam Rabbani Mujaddid Al-Fisani Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi Wa Radiyallahu Ta'ala Anhu, he was an eminent Sufi of the Naqshbandi order, or it was in the Arab world where Ghawsul Azam arose, and may I in passing refer to the achievement of Ghawsul Azam. I'll take only 5 minutes in order to show to you what were these Sufis, great Sufis. When Ghawsul Azam arrived in Baghdad at the command of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, as he writes himself, when he arrived there, what was the condition of the Muslim world? The condition of the Muslim world was that on the one hand, there were the Karamita, or the assassins as they are called in history, assassins. Their leader was Abdullah ibn Maqna, who was an eminent scientist and who posed to be a Sufi, who had found out certain drugs and their use, who had built a paradise underground, called it a paradise, and who would give to drink to his followers hashish. And under this dope, under the influence of this drug, their senses became benumbed. Then he had lighted that underground paradise in a manner in which some of the cabarets of present day are being lighted. He was an eminent scientist, mind you. He had built a moon. That moon would rise from one well and sink in another well after traversing the height. Not the sky exactly, but the height. He was an eminent scientist. And in that, what he called the paradise, he had kept some beautiful women, and he would tell to these intoxicated people, these followers of his, this is the paradise and these are the houris. If you obey me, then you will get all this. Do you want to get that? They said, yes, we want. So then they were commissioned to kill every eminent Muslim that was there in the world. And the government in Baghdad was an imbecile government. The ruler was given to wine and women. He did not care for the administration. And when the Muslims went to him and said, this is happening, all our best Muslims are being killed, he said, these people are gorillas, what can I do? If they come with an army, then I'll send my army. That was one fitna which the Muslim community was not able to face, and which was a very vital threat to the existence of the Islamic community, because these people had already established their kingdom in Egypt. They had already established their strongholds and their fortresses in Syria and Lebanon, and they had their strongest fortress in Iran, in the Qasr al-Mut, as it was called. They had encircled the Islamic metropolis. They had their cells in Yemen. So their plan was finally to capture Makkah and Medina and to proclaim themselves as the rulers of the Islamic empire. On the other side, the mad waves of crusades, they had been coming, and the Christians had conquered Jerusalem and Palestine. The Muslims were imbecile at that time to do anything. The people, as Ghausul Azam himself writes and his biographers write, the ulama and the Sufis of his day, most of them were hypocrites and charlatans. Their sole purpose was to earn money. They would put on a certain type of dress and all that just to cheat the people, to play fraud with them. This was the condition of the community when Ghausul Azam was ordered by the Holy Prophet والسلام, to establish his headquarters in Baghdad. He established his headquarters there. Diamond cuts diamond. He built up an army of fidayeen similar to the one that was coming from Qasr al-Mut. One man for one man, one guerrilla for one guerrilla. And he built them up on the basis of his spiritual teaching, developing in them those spiritual powers which come through becoming Allah's slave. And do you know what happened? The Qasr al-Mut was blown up. The entire hierarchy of this movement of the assassins had to flee from the Islamic empire and to come to Kathiawar and to remain there concealed until the British came and these people came forward as Aga Khanis. Who crushed this movement? Nobody else except Ghausul Azam. And what would happen to the world of Islam if Ghawsul Azam was not there? This is one thing. The other thing, the other great achievement, of course, I can speak for hours and hours and days on the life of Ghawsul Azam. Ghawsul Azam was one of the most eminent Islamic personalities among the followers of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The Muslim world was aghast. Jerusalem and Palestine had been occupied and the Muslim world couldn't do it. Ghawsul Azam started his movement, the Qadiriyya order, of which I also am a very, very, very humble member, and which is even up to this day spread from Indonesia to Morocco, but unfortunately not with the same spirit. Ghawsul Azam established his Qadiriyya order, and it was a member of his Qadiriyya order, Sultan Salahuddin the Great, who, although he was a small chieftain and had a small army, he rose up. He challenged those big hosts of the crusaders and he captured back Palestine and Jerusalem and hit all these crusaders back into Europe. These are only two achievements which I may call here to your minds. Don't think that the Sufis, God forbid, are opium eaters, that the Sufis are ascetics, recluses. This is not Sufis. If you find anyone like that, he is not a Sufi. Every Sufi is a Mujahid. Sufism is jihad, and the spiritual discipline in Sufism prepares a person by purifying him of all his weaknesses into a real Mujahid. And may I tell you in the end that it is not, don't think that it is only the uneducated, it is only the superstitious people. Some people tell me like that, that it is only the superstitious people who believe in Sufism. May I just remind you that the late Dr. Sir Muhammad Iqbal, who was the greatest intellectual giant among Muslims in this century, he was a member of the Qadiriyya order. My dear brothers and my dear sisters, I have got this chit from my well-wishers. They say it is now 11 o'clock. And of course, I should not keep you back. I should also not exert myself too much, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has says, He has said that we should always try to do everything in a balanced way. So I take leave of you and I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He may bestow His blessing on us in this manner, that we may be able to cultivate the love for the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam, and through that love to cultivate love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the sincerest and the truest manner possible, and we also may be able to progress in this path of the pilgrimage of eternity. Ameen.